Hello. Welcome to another edition with Dishing with Dorothy. As Thanksgiving and the other holidays approach, we thought it would be so appropriate to be here at the Ohio Poultry Association with Jim Chakares and team to talk about cooking a turkey and what to do with the leftovers. So Jim is going to be our chef today, and he, like me, believes, as my mother taught me, that you eat with your eyes first. And so we're going to talk about how to make this food, but also how to make this food beautiful. So Jim,
it's you bet. Yours. Well, thank you, Director. We're glad you're here today and to celebrate the holidays with us. You know, first of all, let's talk about turkeys. You know, this is the prime centerpiece of the plate for the holiday meals, and this is an Ohio-raised turkey from Bowman and Landis Farms in New Carlisle, Ohio. I tell everyone that the first step is selecting your turkey. And you want to make sure that either, whether you get fresh or frozen, your results are going to be the same. You just want to make sure and keep that turkey in the refrigerator. And remember that it's going to take several days to thaw a turkey. And there are different suggestions on our website at ohiopoultry.org to help you thaw that turkey. But you want to make sure, and number one is always food safety. Keep it in the refrigerator, even if you're brining your turkey, which is something you can research, and it provides a little extra flavor sometimes in the turkey, but you want to make sure and keep it cold during that whole process. So I get the turkey home and we're ready to go, and we have taken the turkey out of the plastic and we have patted it dry. So that's even the first step, is always to make sure, use a little paper toweling and pat it dry. You don't want to rinse your turkey. You know, just straight into preparing it for the oven. And I always look it over, and sometimes there's a couple little feathers or a little pin feather that's left. I use a little pair of needle nose pliers to get that out, or you can use a knife. Either one. These are just little pin feathers that are left in the turkey. So you want to remove as much of those as possible. And now we're ready to go. And so the next step is, this is an oven roasted turkey. You can fry your turkey. You can spatchcock it, which is kind of cutting it down the middle and put it on the grill. Many different ways to prepare your turkey. But today we're going to talk the classic traditional roast.
Well, Jim, there's one step that we need to talk about, and that was when I get my turkey, there's a little paper bag with some things in it. Tell me what this is, and tell me what you do with it.
Well, these are what we call the giblets, and I think they are just little flavor packages that we want to make sure and use. So I put mine in a stock pot with some water and herbs and some aromatics, garlic, some vegetables, and let that cook down. And then I've got stock that I use to put in my dressing or stuffing or make gravy with. And it's just packed full of flavor. And then you can look at like the meat from the turkey neck and shred that off and put that in your gravy as well, and provides a little bit more substance and texture to that gravy.
You know, now Jim, as a young mother, I remember one time cooking that inside the turkey because I didn't know was in there. And so if that happens, it's no serious issue.
No, because we're cooking the turkey to the proper temperature, which we'll talk about in a minute.
Okay.
But you don't want to make sure, and some people will throw these away, but there's so much goodness here. So we'll set those aside for a minute, and we'll talk about preparing our turkey now. So the first step that I like to do is, once my turkey has been patted dry, is I like to liberally salt and pepper the turkey. And I do that inside and out, and I have a mixture here of about 3/4 kosher salt with 1/4 just freshly ground pepper. And I kind of rub it all over the turkey. And this helps make it a little bit crispy when it comes out of the oven and provides all that extra flavor. One of the things we want to talk about is, when you're cooking, you sometimes make a little mess, but that's okay. It cleans up, and if you don't have fun in the kitchen, then it becomes a task and you don't want to do that. So if you've got a roasting pan with a rack, that's great. A lot of people don't. So I say just find a pan that's big enough, and then I have some onions, carrots, and celery that I'm just going to use in the bottom to kind of create a little nest for my turkey. And that also provides flavor to the drippings.
Now, Jim, we need to talk about, all of those ingredients are from our members at Ohio Proud. We have over 400 members in Ohio Proud program. And so our turkey came from New Carlisle, Ohio. Our potatoes, onions, and carrots also came from Ohio producers. Being a member of Ohio Proud allows us to help ODA to help you market and to advertise your product and to help those producers also find other resources that can help them grow their business. So we're so proud that everything you see on this table today is from an Ohio producer.
It's from Ohio, yes. We're very proud of that, and we've got great farms all across the state of Ohio, and we're celebrating their bounty at Thanksgiving. So it's an age-old question as to whether or not you stuff your stuffing or dressing, whichever you choose to call it, in the turkey or you cook it separately. And I'm not going to tell you which way to do it because it's family tradition. My family, we always cooked it outside of the bird. And just keep in mind that if you do cook it inside the turkey, it takes extra time to cook your turkey, and you're also going to want to make sure and take the temperature of that stuffing or dressing to make sure that it is finished as well. So I'm going to stuff my turkey though, but I'm going to use some of those same vegetables.
And Jim, where can you get a thermometer? There's different kinds of thermometers, and one is specifically a meat thermometer, right?
Yeah, these are all examples of meat thermometers. Most of your larger supermarkets carry them. Of course, you could get them online. I like the instant read that you know, you don't have to wait on the temperature. But we'll talk about that in a minute when we get the turkey out and what the right temperatures are. But I use the vegetables we talked about earlier, some garlic. I like good Ohio apples, whichever ones you like, and even some lemons and oranges. I like a little bit of the citrus.
I love that.
And then finally, I add some herbs. So what is Thanksgiving without some good sage and rosemary, some parsley, and I even put in a little sprig of thyme. So a lot of different herbs, and I just stuff those right in that cavity. And then those aromatics, that flavor permeates the meat as it cooks.
Smells delicious right now. Woo!
And then we just put a little around the bottom to provide more flavor, and we'll even add some apples and more of our citrus. Citrus not from Ohio, but we support our citrus growers out of state.
Yes, we do.
Some more garlic. And you don't really have to peel your garlic, your apples, your onions, because we are not going to eat these. We're just going to use the juices that come out of these, and we'll use that to make our gravy with later.
Wow.
So, and now the final step is I like just take a little softened butter and just brush right on the turkey and just slather it with butter. And now it's ready for the oven. I like to use a 325 degree oven, and you're going to want to cook your turkey about 20 minutes per pound.
Okay.
And so start checking it about halfway through what you've calculated your cooking process to be.
So how big a turkey is this, Jim?
This is a 15 pound turkey.
So 20 minutes times 15 pounds.
20 minutes times 15 pounds, yes. Okay. So you basically figure 3 pounds per hour. So this turkey is going to take somewhere, my guess is I'll start checking it for temperatures at about 3.5 hours, but it's probably going to take about 4.5, maybe 5. But I like to use my meat thermometer. And what I do is you want to check your turkey in 2 or 3 places. So you want to temp it in the breast. And of course I would do this to the turkey as it's cooking, but you want it to be about 165, 170 in the breast. And then you also want to check the thickest part of the thigh, which will come right in here to the thigh. And you want it to read 180 degrees there. If you put your stuffing or dressing inside, you're going to want to check that as well. And that should be 170 degrees as well. So that's when you know your turkey is done. But I put the turkey in the oven uncovered. And then about halfway through, when it's starting to brown, if I think it's brown enough, I'll put a foil tent over it. But we take the turkey in the oven, bring it out. Some people have a little bit of a concern that their turkey never browns. Well, the secret to that is you take some good Ohio maple syrup and you just brush the maple syrup on there, and the sugar in the maple syrup will allow that turkey to brown and get the color for you.
Great to know.
So, yeah. So that's the secret to making your bird look great and to taste great. Now, I baste my turkey 3 or 4 times during the cooking process, and I use a combination of some good dry Ohio white wine and a little bit of butter and some herbs in that. And this is also an Ohio Pinot Grigio, a little on the drier side. And I also put just a little bit of this wine around the base of the turkey to provide some moisture, and it gives a little bit of a wine steam bath to our turkey. And this makes it even more delicious. So with that, we're ready for the oven.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we need to talk about rack, Jim, or just, in other words, how much space you need to have above or below?
Just so it fits.
Okay.
Center of the oven is ideal.
Okay. There you go.
The turkey is now done and out of the oven. I think we all agree that it's beautiful. That skin is crispy. It's going to be juicy and succulent when we slice into that turkey. I like to put my turkey right on the carving board and then decorate it when all your guests walk in and are impressed by what they see. That's the moment you've been slaving over in the kitchen for all day. You want to make sure that it's a beautiful presentation piece. And then, you know, I like to decorate. We've got some pomegranates, kumquats, cranberries, just all the different flavors of the season, and add a little bit of color to the plate with some herbs, some great Ohio apples there. I then carve the turkey, and then I put it on my platter to serve with the meal. I think that works a little bit better than trying to put it on the platter and then trying to carve it and then taking it back. It's just one less step you don't have to worry about.
Now, Jim, when you take it out of the oven, do you need to let it rest before you carve?
You do. That's a very good point, Director. I like to let it rest 15 or 20 minutes at least. And we should talk a little bit about, you know, depends on how big of a crowd you're expecting for your holiday meal. But you want about 1 to 1.5 pounds of turkey pre-cooking weight. And that'll give you a good size serving for each person, plus a little bit of leftovers. If you've got a big crowd coming, my number one tip is to cook 2 smaller turkeys. Mm-hmm. And so for this year, for my turkey, we may have 25 people. So instead of cooking a big 28, 30 pound turkey, I'm gonna cook 2 14, 15 pound turkeys. And I can cook 1, 2, or 3 days ahead of time, have it all sliced and ready to go. So I just have to reheat it, maybe with a little broth, and bring it right back. And then I've got my one turkey to show everyone when they come in.
Wonderful. That's a great suggestion.
Yeah, and you know, it goes great with any of our Ohio wines. And people often ask me, what wine should they enjoy with their turkey? Should it be white? Should it be dry or sweet? What about red? And my answer to that is drink what you like, because I think turkey goes with everything. Big, bold reds, a sweet white, a nice crisp white, they all work well. A nice blush or a rosé, it all goes with turkey.
You know, that advice about cooking 2 turkeys instead of a great big one should be a big help for people when they're shopping for their turkey this year. Sometimes we go to the store with a specific idea about what size turkey it should be, and this allows a lot more flexibility when you see what's available in the store.
It does, and it's less time in the oven, which means you've got time to cook all those other great side dishes.
Yeah, great. You know, Jim, when I was growing up, my dad and my brother would go out hunting during the day. And while the turkey was cooking, my mom set us 3 girls out to set the table and to make the turkey boots. So today we're going to show how to make turkey boots. And I'm going to have you make one, and I'll make one. These directions are available on our website so that you can make them. You're going to fold the piece of paper in a half, again, lengthwise. And Jim, you're going to lay this on top of the other one. And now you're going to take a pair of scissors and you're going about 2/3 of the way down, make cuts as evenly as possible. And this would be a great thing for your kids to do either the day before or the day of, as they anxiously await for dinner to be served. Now we're going to take each leg, unfold it, and fold it the opposite way. Okay, like this. And kind of fluff the edges out a little bit like this, all right? Now, Jim, you're going to take your leg and you're going to take this piece of paper and wrap it around your turkey. And you can wrap it around as many times as you want, and that'll make it all the fluffier. You can use tape if you want, or you can just leave it just like that. And there you have what we call turkey boots.
And we should note that you should do this after the turkey comes out of the oven, not before.
And you do not bake these in the oven. That's a good point, Jim. We don't want a fire. I'd like to share with you a couple of things that are special to our family. First of all, I'd love to share with you my favorite turkey picture. My son was 3 weeks old on Thanksgiving Day in 1983, and if you'll see, he's a little bit smaller than the turkey that year. So, special memories. You know, when you gather, and Jim talked about having 25 plus people there, there's a wide variety of ages and interests. And things that we've found are timeless for our family are things that probably you've all enjoyed, but maybe there's some new ones. Uno is a great game. You know, I think we're on our third version of this. Whether you're 5 or 55, Uno is a challenge. And even having a younger one sit on your lap and help with the colors and the numbers is great. We also like Spot It. And Spot It is a game that can be played with one or more. And you have to identify on two cards what the similarities are. And believe it or not, it's harder than you think. So Spot It is another game, timeless. Another game that we love is called Fact, or we'll call it Fiction. But you can see what the name is. And it's great, and I have a question for Jim. So, Fact or Fiction, Jim, ducks have no eyelids.
Well, Director, you may be stumping me here, but I'm going to say ducks do have eyelids.
That's correct.
There we go.
Jim knows his stuff. And these are great questions, such as modern pianos have 88 keys, true or false. And so, again, great thing to bring all ages together. Finally, if you have that quiet teenager or someone else, this is a great book, a great gift for anyone ages 8 to 88. 365 days of art, and you can just have this laying out for someone with a variety of pencils or anything. So this is about creating memories, not about perfection. And so we hope that some of these things will help you create memories. You know, even though we never had a single guest at our house, usually for Thanksgiving, we were always in charge of making place cards for my sisters and brothers and mom and dad. And one of the place cards that I found this year that I thought was really cute is a pumpkin place card. Very simple. And so you can take a piece of construction paper like this, hold it horizontally, and cut it into strips 1 inch wide. You'll take your glue stick and you'll take those and you'll cut this in half again to make a strip this long. Take those strips with your glue stick and make them into a circle. And then once that's dried, start pulling them to the center and gluing them together. Okay? Again, perfection is not the goal here. It's just to have fun as a family. Your kids can make these the day before or the day of. And then you take a piece of paper, make a leaf out of it, put your guest's name or family member's name on it, take another piece of paper and make your stem, and there you have a pumpkin place card.